The Geneva Conventions are something you have almost certainly heard of, and maybe even know a little bit about. Even if you aren't a total nerd who knows about a lot of UN conventions and makes ASMR readings of foreign constitutions. This is because these treaties have played a huge role in the contemporary world, most notably in transforming how we fight wars in the modern day. So what do these treaties specify, and how did they come into being? Without a doubt, maybe unless you're playing a war-themed video game, war is a pretty crappy experience. Wars destroy countries and economies alike for generations, displace anywhere from hundreds to millions, tear apart communities, destroy important basic infrastructure, can leave behind artifacts which cause even more suffering after the fighting has ended, and has psychological effects on combatants and civilian alike, even in those on the winning side. For most of human history, war was basically a free-for-all, which led to a whole host of horrors that many national governments eventually decided was maybe a little bit too much, even for empires at war. The Geneva Conventions, hence the plural, actually refer to a series of four different treaties signed on four different occasions, one in 1864, one in 1906, one in 1929, and one most notably in 1949, as well as two more conventions in The Hague in 1899 and 1907. These conventions established what would be considered on the international stage as war crimes, defining the rights that would be afforded to non-combatants, as well as what should even be allowed in warfare at all. This idea first came into fruition after Swiss businessman Henri Dunant visited soldiers wounded during the Battle of Solferino in 1859, a date my high school science teacher always insisted was the most important in human history, but that's a story for another time. Dunant was shocked and horrified to see just how little help these soldiers were receiving, and so proposed a humanitarian relief agency to help all injured combatants during a war, which would come to form the Red Cross. However, this Red Cross and Red Crescent movement would need help, not necessarily scientific or logistical, but diplomatic. When Dunant proposed the idea of what would become the Red Cross, he also proposed there be an intergovernmental treaty recognizing the neutrality of this and other such organizations, in order to allow them to treat soldiers from both sides without hindrance. This sparked the 1864 Geneva Convention, with 12 European countries signing the agreement, along with following agreements signed by more and more countries. Seriously though, he founded the Red Cross and called for the Geneva Conventions? This guy might just be one of the most influential people you probably never heard of. The first convention answered Dunant's requests, and naturally laid a lot of the groundwork for the following conventions, including rulings that the sick and injured must be treated without regard to any demographic differences, and cannot be subject to extermination, torture, or experimentation. It also called for all parties to search for sick and wounded soldiers after a battle had finished, and to immediately report them to the ICRC, or the International Committee of the Red Cross. The second convention had a bit of a nautical theme to it, as it established what exactly to do regarding naval warfare, notably in establishing what a hospital ship is, that saving shipwrecked personnel is a must, and that neutral parties, i.e. merchant ships or yachts or Switzerland, who agree to provide medical assistance for a particular warship, cannot themselves be fired on, provided they still remain neutral. The third convention established the rules on how prisoners of war, or POWs, are allowed to be treated, notably in that they should be fed, housed in a clean facility, and given communication to the outside world, as well as receiving required treatment, namely among female POWs, only be required to disclose their name, rank, birthday, and military service number, and be repatriated when they fall seriously ill, or released when the fighting stops, and also sent home if they request. Finally, the fourth convention was a pretty big one, as it set forth the rights of civilians, and was also signed literally 4 years after the most devastating war in human history had ended, having seen upwards of 45 million civilian deaths alone. The fourth convention mandates that civilians never be attacked, tortured, or discriminated against, safe zones in hospitals be set up for vulnerable people, civilians be able to live as close to their normal lives as possible, and in occupied territories laws still be in force, both provided they don't pose a high enough security risk, prohibits pillage and destruction of property, and mandates all medical and religious items be allowed passage without restriction. Basically, it does its best to lift the burden of war off of civilians as much as possible. So to quickly recap, the first convention, signed in 1864, establishes protection for sick and injured soldiers. The second convention, signed in 1906, establishes the rules of naval warfare. The third convention, signed in 1929, establishes protection and fair conditions for prisoners of war. And the fourth convention, signed in 1949, establishes the rights and protections afforded to civilians and non-combatants. So there you go, you can take your exam now. However, do keep in mind that that was a super simplified summary of the four, and the first three were also modified slightly when the fourth was signed. In addition, there are also the three protocols. Protocol 1 specifically forbids indiscriminate attacks, attacks on cultural sites and important infrastructure like dams, and weapons that can cause civilian suffering long after the fighting has ended. Think unexploded landmines and cluster bombs. Protocol 2 basically concentrates all the aforementioned rules onto parties fighting civil wars, though do note they don't generally apply to things like protests and demonstrations. And finally, Protocol 3 allows the Red Cross and Red Crescent to also use the Red Crystal as another emblem, which seems incredibly minor, but seeing as to how their other logos are a cross and a crescent, you can imagine as to why those symbols might be a little problematic in some certain scenarios. In total, all four Geneva Conventions and 1, 2, 3, or none of the protocols have been signed by 196 current sovereign governments, including every single member of the UN, plus the two UN observer states of Vatican City and Palestine, plus the New Zealand constituent country of the Cook Islands. However, since the conventions got their last big patch over a Cold War ago, many today believe that they may in fact not be perfectly up to date. I know, right? A document defining the rules of war that was written in 1949 could possibly be outdated? Who would have thunk it? No, but seriously, wars have changed a lot in the last 71 years. What with all the separatist movements and asymmetric conflicts and terrorist groups and drone warfare and threat of nuclear annihilation. In addition, to say that these rules have always been fully respected ever since their signing would be a huge lie. The conventions have been violated on all sides. However, these treaties have still been a huge success in the international community, and they have helped define what can truly be considered a war crime, and at the very least, tell modern warfare when to calm the hell down. Thanks as always for watching. I realize I didn't go all heavy with the jokes this time around, but to be fair, the underlying subject matter at hand was war, so yeah. Either way, if you enjoyed this video, please give it a like, share it, follow me on social media perhaps, and subscribe to learn something new every Sunday.